Lord Jesus, we want to thank you for this time that you have given us. Lord, we ask you that during these moments, you might be with us in the midst of us and anoint us with your Holy Spirit, that every word that I speak and every word that they hear, Lord, might touch our lives, might inspire us and change our lives forever. Holy Spirit, be with us throughout this time. Mother Mary, please intercede for us. Protect us within your virginal blue mantle. Pray for us that this time might be a time of great transformation in our lives. Hail Mary, full of grace, the Lord is with thee. Blessed art thou amongst women, and blessed is the fruit of thy womb, Jesus. Holy Mary, Mother of God, pray for us sinners now and at the hour of our death. Amen. Okay, so can you hear me clearly? Okay. All right. So today we know is the feast of St. John Paul II. So St. John Paul II and St. Gianna, they are the patrons of the World Meeting of Families. So we had gone to Philadelphia for the World Meeting, and we were really, you know, surprised to see people from around 100 countries were there. We had a crowd of around 20,000. So we were really blessed to be a part of the great gathering with the religious and with the priests. It was a time of great blessing. And the most beautiful thing was that we got to meet a lot of world-famous Catholic speakers who we listened to their keynote sessions, and there were a few breakout sessions. So I tried to cover most of the topics mentioned in the keynotes, and whatever breakout sessions, a few which I at my family attended, I've put down a few points among those. And if you want to listen to the entire keynote sessions and a few breakout sessions, the links are there in the World Meeting of Families site. I've put that in the PPT also. So I think we'll just start with the first. So this was the
I'm not sharing it.
Yeah, I'm just, let's see. Okay, anyways, I was able to see it before, but I'm not able to share it now.
Yeah, it's coming up.
Oh, is it?
Yep, it's good.
Can you see the PPT?
Yep, we can see.
Okay. So this was the motto of the World Meeting of Families. Love is our mission, family fully alive. Called together from all over the world in faithful celebration of the family, the sanctuary of love and life. So the first keynote session was by Bishop Robert Barron. He's a very famous preacher, as we all know. And personally for us, you know, we have been listening to his sermons through the Word on Fire ministry, like for the past 3 or 4 years. So we really were really excited to meet him. And the topic that he spoke about was living as the image of God, created for joy and love. Are you able to see that slide? Yes? Okay, fine. So one of the first things that Bishop Robert Barron spoke about is that today's world, it tries to create an image where, you know, man can live without God. So today, you know, the atheists of the world, today's great thinkers, the great happening, those people who really matter today, they have created a thought in our minds that we do not really need God. Because they think that, you know, the more glory we give to God, the less glory man receives. But what Bishop Barron says is that this is actually not true in the case of Christianity. And he says that there is no religion which raises a human dignity higher than Christianity. And he says that, you know, the true image of Christianity is that of a burning bush, which, you know, we know that Moses saw the burning bush. So what Christianity says is that the closer we come to God, or the closer God comes to us, he does not consume us because he is not against us. The closer God comes to us, we become radiant and beautiful, and we radiate the glory of God. That is why he says, Saint Irenaeus says, that the glory of God is man fully alive. So Christianity, he says, there is no other religion which raises human dignity much more than Christianity. So one of the main things that Genesis teaches us is that, you know, that we are created in the image and likeness of God. So God did not, God is not not against man, but the glory of God is actually man fully alive. So, and one important thing that Bishop Barron said is that when we speak about the image of God, it is not a private privilege that is for us, just for our, you know, just for us, our safekeeping. It is actually a mission, a responsibility that God has actually given us. So we will come to that. So one of the most striking points in Bishop Barron's session was that he said that Adam, or the first man who was created in the image and likeness of God, the mission, that mission that God had given him to be the priest, prophet, and king. We'll cover those points in detail. So he says that in the book of Genesis, when we look into the account of creation, it is like a beautiful liturgical procession. In the Mass, like we know that in the, during the Mass, we have the altar boys and the person with the word of God, and then the priest, and finally the bishop comes. So the most important person comes and the last. So similarly, in the book of Genesis, God, he created the heavens, the earth, the stars, the sun, the moon, all the plants, animals, everything. And finally, he created man. So man was like, you know, the most important of all creation. So the first and most important duty of man is to bring the entire creation together into the praise of God. So, you know, we know that in the beginning, all these sun and moon, everything was worshipped. But Christianity teaches us that these are not to be worshipped. They are actually, along with us, they sing praises to the Creator. So as the priest, Adam's duty was to unite the entire creation in a voice of praise of the Creator. The second thing that Adam, the job, the task, the mission that God gave Adam was, he brought all the animals to Adam and asked him to name them according to the intelligence that God had given him. So that is where Adam becomes the first prophet. Because what the prophet does is, he speaks the truth according to the divine word, or according to the intelligence that God has given him, or according to what God has inspired him to do, he teaches the truth. So Adam was the first prophet because he cataloged all the animals according to the intelligence that God had given him. So the lion as a lion, and the camel and the camel, so like that. And the third mission that God had given Adam was to be the king. So he had given Adam the job of taking care of the Garden of Eden. So he was to tend and care for the garden and for all those who were in it. So he says that the king's mission, and similarly, you know, Adam's job was to make the whole world like Eden. Okay. So as the king brings order and harmony into the world, the job of Adam was to bring order and harmony into the Garden of Eden. So all this was the mission of Adam before the fall. Okay. So Bishop, what he compares us, you know, as we are all the children of Adam, he says that, you know, we are all, as we are created in the image of God, we are all called to be a priest, prophet, and king wherever we are. So as a priest, you know, we are supposed to give the right praise to God. We are supposed to bring entire creation together in praise of God. So that we do wherever we are, in our families, in our communities, wherever we go, we make sure that we always praise God through our lives. Okay. And being a prophet, being a prophet means, you know, speaking the truth. So we know that in this world, we know that moral truths, they're all being, you know, people tweak them according to their own desires. So we know that, you know, everything, marriage has been tweaked, everything that God taught us that it should be like this has been tweaked according to man's, you know, man's freedom. So man is actually misusing the freedom that God has given him. He decides what is right and what is wrong. So in that situation, in this world, we are called to be prophets who speak the truth about this is not how it is supposed to be, or this is not how God intended it to be. So, and one beautiful example that Robert Barron spoke about was about Prophet Elijah. So he lived in the troubled time of Israel, where people were going behind false gods and there were a lot of problems in Israel. The king was going the wrong way, the queen. That was when Prophet Elijah calls together all the prophets of Baal and says that, Today we will decide who is the real God. You offer a sacrifice for your God. We will offer a sacrifice for our God. Now we will decide who is the real God. So Bishop Barron said that, you know, God's prophets like Elijah will always be thin on the ground, because there was only one prophet of God and there were 450 prophets of Baal. We know that it is very true in the world today. There are a lot of people who speak, you know, what claims to be the truth, but there are only few like the Catholic Church who stand for the truth. And we know that the world sees us as the greatest enemy. So that happens, it has happened in ancient times, it has happened today. So our job is, you know, as prophets, to always stand for the truth as what God intended us to be, not as the world intends it to be. Third thing, as kings. So what Bishop says is that, you know, a king is always supposed to go on a campaign. A king is always on a mission. He said, you know, the example of David, it is said in the Bible that when kings went on campaign, David stayed in his palace, and that is why he fell into sin with Bathsheba. So the job of a king is always to go on a mission, on a campaign, to bring order and harmony into the world. So as kings, you know, we should always realize that that's what Father Bishop said in the beginning, that being created in the image of God, it is not something that we keep to ourselves and say, this is my private matter, or worship is my private matter, or, you know, being Catholic is my private matter. No, we are all sent on a mission to do what the Lord has, you know, the mission that God has given us to do, so that the world will see it, so that, you know, it will bring order and harmony into the world and into the lives of the people around us. And can you see the second slide? Yes. Okay. So he spoke a lot about the priest, prophet, and king aspects. We're not covering everything in detail, but I request all of you to listen to that keynote session, because it is really worth listening to. So because I had to take this webinar, I listened to it like around 3-4 times, and the more I listened, I got a lot of insights. So what he says is that, you know, family is where the Imago Dei is the image of God, comes to life. So we should always remember that in our families, wherever we are the militant church. We are the militant church on the march, on the mission. So we should remember that every day of our life, the Lord has entrusted us with a mission, which we're not supposed to forget, no matter what situation of life we are in, whether we are youth, we are children, we are family, we are husband, wife. We should always remember that this is the mission that God has given me, to put the image of God into the missionary aspect in my life. So how do we nurture? So what he says is that in our families, our job, you know, as parents or as spouses, is to nurture priests, prophets, and kings in our families. How do we do that? When we practice the right kind of praise, when we tell our children and when we tell our spouses that the right praise should be given to God. Today, the world has put a lot of stakes above God. Glory, career, we have our worldly pleasures, but all that should always take the last place. God should take the first place in our life. That we are meant to give praise to God. This is a message that we should convey to others, and especially our family members. That is how we should raise up our children. When we do that, when we make sure that the right praise is given to the Creator, we become, and we nurture children to become priests. Secondly, when we teach moral truths, when we discuss about moral truths at home, in the churches, in our communities, you know, when we hold debates about what is the truth, or what about, for example, when we talk about abortion, when we talk about gay marriage activities, all this, you know, we are teaching moral truths. We are teaching what the law, what the church is teaching us. We are spreading the word about what truth is, about how God intended it to be. That is when. So when we discuss these moral truths in our families, when we bring up our children in these truths, we are raising them to be prophets of God. The third thing is when we encourage missions in our families. You know, when we, mission is not just, you know, not as high as, you know, going to some missionary place. Even, you know, practicing a community life in church, the serving in the church, everything with a missionary aspect. So when we do all that, we are actually teaching our children to be kings, marching into the world as kings. And, you know, one important point which many of us noticed in Bishop Robert Barron's session was that he mentioned that when we hear about this phrase, the gates of hell shall not prevail against us, most of the time the image that we have is, you know, as if the hell is marching towards us and we are, you know, like trying to prevent it with some shield or something like that. But Bishop said it's not like that. So It is like, you know, we know that in the ancient times, like if there is a nation, the nation is surrounded by a gate, and that is for the protection of that nation. So when the enemy marches into that nation, what they do is first they try to destroy the great gate. Similarly, what he says is, we are on the march, and hell has something to fear from us. We are on the march. And he says that the gates of heaven hell shall not prevail against us. When we march forward, you know, they have something to fear. It's not like they come towards us and we are trying to prevent them. We are on the march. We are the militant church. We are on the mission. So hell has something to fear from us. One is they worship together. So the thing that the most important thing they said is that whenever we go for mass, sit together with your whole family, so that our children will also see that we're supposed to attend mass as a family. And they shared the testimony of Timothy Dolan, who said that, you know, that when they used to go for mass, their parents used to sit together holding hands with each other, and one parent would attend to children on one side and the other parent would attend to the children on the other side. It's such a beautiful, you know, small things which may seem irrelevant for us, but these are things that inspire our children to grow up as priests and religious when they see how important the mass and worship is for the parents. Second thing, you know, they said that we should pray together, especially they said that, you know, the family, the Holy Rosary is such a beautiful gift from God, because that is the time that we sit together with our family for prayer. And, you know, they said that, you know, that the faith, that faith that we practice, it should be the source of warmth for our homes. You know, when we pray the Holy Rosary, we should all sit together, hold hands, and, you know, share that intimacy with each other and with our children. And when we do that, you know, our kids will, you know, grasp a lot from it. That prayer always draws us into a deeper communion with God and with others. And then the third thing that they said is, you know, that a Catholic family is called to intimacy. So intimacy is a measure of love. So we know that, you know, that we always say that love, I love you, that love cannot be measured and all that. Intimacy actually talks about how much we love each other. So, you know, the way the parents deal with each other, the way they interact with each other, all this has a profound effect on the children. And in fact, it helps them to develop satisfactory relationships with others in the future. And then the another point is to always put family first, to make sure that, you know, we have, all of us have busy lives, but always remember that we should put our family first. They mentioned one beautiful point: waste time with your kids. That is one of the most important keys to evangelization, because we know that evangelization, after all, is about wasting time with people. You know, if you want to evangelize somebody, you just can't say that in one sentence. You need to spend time with them, you know, speak to them, listen to their problems and all. So they said, waste time with your kids. I've been trying to do that after that. it's a big struggle, but I know it. But that sentence was always there in my mind. And then, you know, and one important thing that they said about prayer. Most of us, you know, they complain that, you know, his wife Lisa was saying, you know, some of us complain that we don't have time to pray with, I don't have time to pray with my spouse. So prayer is not about, you know, the length of it. It is about how much life we put into it. So suppose, you know, you want to pray for your spouse, it doesn't mean that you have to sit down somewhere and pray. When your spouse is leaving for work, you can just, you know, just hold him or her by the hand and just say, Lord, please bless my husband, bless my wife as she goes on work today. Bless, anoint her with your Holy Spirit, anoint him with your Holy Spirit. That is a prayer, when you say it in the right spirit. And then one important thing, another thing they said is that when you teach our little children to pray, and this is one of the one of the points that I really want to stress. You know, most of us, you know, we all want our children to grow up in prayer and faith and all that. So sometimes we try to impose a lot of prayer on our children. When I used to do that, and you know, I used to make my children pray the entire rosary. But you know what they said is, especially when little children, they start learning to pray, do not, you know, start with a lot of express. For this example, for a four-year-old child or a five-year-old child, you can just start with maybe one decade of history, but just read the mystery and ask them, like, what do you think about this? You know, what do you think, for example, if you're contemplating on the Annunciation, just ask your child, like, what do you think Mother Mary would have felt when the angel Gabriel came to her and spoke to her? So what would you do if an angel were to come to you? So make sure that your child lives out that short time of prayer. And then once you feel that your child has actually, you know, understood the beauty of that prayer, then gradually introduce them to the entire rosary so that the prayer does not become a burden for our child, so that the child actually starts to relish prayer. So, you know, we have tried to practice that. I think it makes entire, you know, we're able to see prayer from a wholly different perspective, and it puts a lot of beauty to prayer. And the fifth point is, you know, the family is a witness and sign. So one of the things that they said is, you know, when we go out as a family to have dinner together. So when we sit at the dinner table, everybody else is sitting there chatting. So when our family, when food is served before us, we quickly make a sign of the cross and say grace. Immediately people notice us because we are becoming a witness over there or a sign that you know, Christ is the one who unites us. And then people see them gathered around a table, there are so many of them, they have 10 kids, so there are so many of them. When they see their joyful faces, people ask them, you know, what is it that makes you so happy and joyful? Then they say, that gives them a chance to share about Jesus. They say that Jesus is the center of our life, so we're so happy, so that makes us so happy. And then, so that doesn't mean one thing, you know, when I heard all this, I thought, you know, these people, their lives are perfect. No, their lives are not perfect. You know, as they said, every house has dishes flying at one point of time. So you know, Liza Popchak was talking about one incident where, you know, she was washing dishes and most of her kids were crying around her. They were shouting. She was also shouting back at them, and she didn't know what to do. Finally, what she said is, okay, everybody on the couch. So they immediately thought, you know, something's wrong. Mom is asking us to come on the couch. Then she said, see, I'm really angry, and you're also really disturbed. Why don't you guys just, you know, just put your hands on my head and pray for me? And immediately those children, they put their hands on their mother's head and prayed for her. Lord, please bless mom to control her temper. Please help us to be good. And suddenly she said there was, you know, an outpouring of the Holy Spirit upon them. So that really struck me, you know, no family is perfect. There's no perfect family. There is no perfect spouse. But, you know, it is when we pray, when we go for the sacraments, it gives us an amount of grace to handle our situations with, you know, in the way that the Lord wants us to. So these are among the many points. And there, you know, their breakout session is also there on the World Meeting of Family site. If you can, please go through the entire session. It's really good. Okay. So then... Okay, so here I've just put a few points combined from two, three sessions combined. You know, I think most of us already know this, that family is an icon of the Trinity. So we know that, you know, that when we talk about the family, why family is so important, why God created the family, is because, you know, God himself is not alone. God himself is a family. So there is God, in God, there is the Father, there is the Son, and the essence of that family, which is love, which is the Holy Spirit. So Trinity itself is, you know, denotes a family. That's why we say the family is an icon of the Trinity. So, and in the Trinity, there is a communion of persons. We have the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. They are distinct. They are distinct in the sense that, you know, each of them have a separate role. Father is not the Son, Son is not the Father, but they have different roles. But the love that they have unites them in their distinction. Okay. So, and the love of the Trinity, the uniqueness of that love is that it is a radical self-donative love. It is not a love which keeps that love to itself, but it is a giving love, a love which is sacrificial love. That is the love of the Trinity, and that is the love which God wants us to have in our families too. So when God created the first human family, he created man and woman equal in dignity, just like the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, complementary in relation. It's like God the Father is the Father of the Son, and the Son is the Son of the Father. He created the human family in a sense that you have a husband, you have a wife, and each is called to make a gift of self to the other. And another aspect of the Trinitarian love is that it is incarnational. Because if the Trinity itself was happy and satisfied in itself, there was no need for the Trinity to create human beings. So their love is always giving, and that is the same incarnational love to which God has also called every family. Okay, so, and this living symbol of the fidelity of God, family is a living symbol of the fidelity of God. This was one of the most important points mentioned by Cardinal Robert Sarah. I've not put his entire points, just this point, living symbol of the fidelity of God. You know, when we see a family, it reminds us of how God is so faithful to us, because we know that, as you said, you know, no family is perfect. We have our own imperfections, but we strive to go together in this journey, you know, because the Lord has called us to be faithful to each other. And he mentioned a beautiful story about, you know, the September 11th attacks, when World Trade Center was, you know, torn down, and one of the firemen, he lost his life. And his wife was actually expecting their 10th child. And how, you know, even in the midst of such a tragedy, she was able to be faithful to God and her husband and to bring up those children. And it seems that, you know, that one of their children is now joining the seminary. So it was a beautiful testimony of Jean Palomba, that's the name of that woman, and her husband. She lost her husband. I think he was a firefighter who lost his life in the World Trade Center attack. And you know how she kept her faithfulness to God, and how she forgave the enemies, those who, you know, killed her husband, and how she kept her faithful love to her husband and brought up those 10 children. So it teaches that, you know, even in the midst of the greatest of tragedies, the family is called to be a living witness of how faithful God is, how faithful the love of God is. Okay, so just a few points. And then let me just show you, this was the icon of the World Meeting of Families. It is a picture which we are not seeing much. It shows Jesus, Mother Mary, Saint Joseph, Saint Anne, and Saint Joachim. So this picture is actually, you know, shows us that family is made up of the young and the old. Family is not just, you know, the small nuclear family that we are, but, you know, equal importance is to be given to the presence of grandparents, cousins, relatives in our family. The reason I put this picture here is the next session, which was by Professor Helen Alvare. I don't know if you've heard of her. I was also seeing her for the first time, but she's a professor of law. But, you know, when I visited some of the, you know, pro-life sites, she's called birth control's worst enemy. And she's one of the, you know, most powerful feminine voices of the church, and one of the people like whom John Paul II would call a feminine genius. Okay, she speaks for the pro-life movement. She's a part of the pro-life. She's a powerful speaker for the church. Okay, and so her session was about, you know, creating the future, the fertility of Christian love. So just as we said earlier, she said that, you know, family was part of God's plan. Okay, you know, God could have the most important example itself is that of Jesus. God would have actually come into this world without the intervention of a human mother, but he chose to come to be part of a family. He chose to be born of a human mother. He chose to live as a normal human being in a family till he was 30 years old, to show us the importance of family in God's plan. And another important point that she said was, you know, a stable, loving family leads to a healthy, peaceful society. We all know that, you know, whenever we see somebody with a criminal history, the first thing that we think is, you know, this person, there was something wrong in his family. And we know that that's very true, especially here when a lot of people are born, you know, they're raised with single mothers, there is a lot of violence in the families. That all affects the character formation of children in the family. That's how people, you know, start. We learn to accept them as they are. It is part of a learning process to how to deal with difficult people in our workplaces, in our community life. So family is the first place where we learn to deal with people, where we learn to accept people, the different kind of people, people with different characters in our society. And what she said, ourselves by losing ourselves in loving others, you know. When we start life as a family, we know that it's no longer about loving ourselves and seeking our joy. It's when we come into a family life that we start to learn about sacrificial love, that, you know, sacrificing ourselves for the joy of others. So that's the first lesson that we learn in a family. And giving the world the look of love that they crave. Okay. So Helen Alvarez, she speaks a lot from experience because she had a disabled sister at home. She had her grandparents at home. She knew that it was very difficult to accept people who are different from other, from us. But she, you know, through her you know, upbringing in such a beautiful family, she was able to accept people with disabilities, give them the look of love that they crave. And this is a point that, you know, Pope Benedict the 16th always says, you know, that we should be able to give the world the look of love that they crave. That's one of the lessons that we learn in a family, to love everyone, you know, to give them the look of love that they really, really desire, irrespective of, you know, what they mean, how, you know, how different they may be from us, how difficult it is for us to accept them, give them the look of love that they crave. Then another point that she said about, you know, today's world is really afraid of accepting new life. Because today's world sees new life as a big responsibility, a big disability. Today we know everybody's speaking about women's freedom and all that, but you know, the true joy in accepting new life, our families should show the world how beautiful it is to accept new life. And that is the first step towards accepting new people with joy. We know that, you know, how difficult we feel when there is a new person who comes to our company who's very different from us and whom it's difficult for us to accept. So it is from our family that we learn, you know, accepting new persons comes with a lot of responsibility and challenges, but it is part of life, okay? So these are lessons that we learn from our family. And then she said, you know, we should always have an attitude of abundance, be a man and woman for others. Let the world learn from us that great joy lies in giving. And she said, fertility is not a disability. But it is not a disability, a message, strong message for the world today and women today. But the message of Christ is always to be fruitful and to multiply. Okay, so just a few points. You should listen to her session because it's so beautiful. She's put the points together so beautifully, and I think you'll be really inspired. Okay? Now, one of the breakout sessions that we attended, it was about fostering vocations at home. I know that these sessions are really a bit different from each other, and it's a challenge for me also because people of different wavelengths were speaking in, you know, at different sessions. So I've tried as much as possible to put everything together. So if you really want to know more, please go to the site and listen to all the sessions. Okay, be really helpful. So fostering vocations. Now, what is vocation? Vocation is a response to God's call to love. And what love? It is a self-giving, generous love. Okay, so this session was actually taken by four nuns. They were from four different congregations. So they were sharing about how, you know, they came to accept, you know, accept God's call in their lives and came to their respective vocations. So family is the first school of authentic love. That is where we learn, as Professor Helen said, family is where we learn to give love, you know, without expecting anything in return. Without counting the cost, that is where family is where we learn to love, you know, a self-donating love, as we said earlier. So pray. So if you want, you know, our children to, you know, seriously discern their vocations, what we should do is, even when they are young, we should pray as a family together for the Lord to reveal His will in our lives. We should also allow our children to have a beautiful relationship with God, so that, you know, they can speak to Him and He can speak to them. Because after all, it is all about responding to God's call. So unless we have a beautiful personal relationship with God, we will not know when He calls us to a vocation. Then they say, you know, receive grace through the sacraments. As you know, as we said earlier, no family is perfect, no spouse is perfect. Life is difficult for every one of us. So even if we need to foster vocations at home, even if, you know, we need to build a culture of love, self-giving love at home, we need grace. And that is why we need to, you know, rely on the sacraments, our daily mass, our confession, so that we receive that abundant grace which is required to give that self-giving love. And then pass on the faith to your children. You know, we should not be ashamed of our faith. We should be proud of our faith, and we should show our children. I know that, you know, most of us from our personal experience, we know that, you know, before coming to Jesus Youth or before having a personal relationship with the Lord, Sunday Mass was just a routine for us. Confession was a burden for us. But after we came to Jesus Youth, the Lord became our personal Savior. We can all say from experience that Holy Mass is the most beautiful time of our life, of our day. And you know, confession is a time of great joy for us. So this is the faith, this is the joy and beauty that we have to pass on to our children. So they relish the sacraments, that it doesn't become a burden for them, but they relish it. And then another important point is respond with courage to the hurts in life. You know, we should not show our children that we are always happy, that, you know, nothing wrong happens in our life. We should show our children that when we go wrong, or when something wrong happens in our life, how do we respond to it? When things go wrong, when we lose our job, when we lose a child, you know, how do we respond to it with God? That is one important lesson that our children have to learn, because we know that life is not perfect. And unless our children receive that training from home, they will not have this, you know, emotional maturity to deal with situations, difficult situations which they may come across in their life. Respond with courage to the hurts in life, you know, and never be afraid to ask forgiveness to your children when we hurt them, you know, with or without our knowledge. To always, you know, show them the merciful love. This one, reveal God's merciful love to your children. That's the last point, you know. Show them that, you know, even when we go wrong, even when we are imperfect, God is perfect and He loves us in a perfect way, not because of what we have done, but because of who He is and how He loves us, you know, without any condition. And then active role in the life of the church. I think one of the points that we said earlier, we should show our kids that, you know, Sunday is for the church. You know, to actively get involved in different ministries and activities. Our children know that, you know, that my parents are doing, this is the right thing to do. This is how I should serve the church. This is how I should contribute to the church. The next session was, you know, Cardinal Luis Antonio Tagle. He is the Bishop of Manila, Philippines. He's such a wonderful, you know, a wonderful shepherd. And his session was truly, truly from the heart. And the topic was the family, a home for the wounded heart. So I think those points are, you know, so simple. So one of the points, beautiful points that he mentioned, you know, wounds are personal. Everybody has a wound. But, you know, that wounds affect relationships, right? So even in our families, we know that if one person is wounded, it will definitely affect our relationship with our family members. They make us vulnerable and alienate us from others. So when a person is wounded, his first reaction is to always, you know, go to an isolated place and sit down and be buried in his own wound. But what Bishop says is that we should realize that the church, the body of Christ, is made up of wounded persons. So we know that the family is the domestic church. We are also made up of wounded persons. So when a person is wounded, what we should do is not to alienate them, not to allow them to alienate themselves from us. But just like the ministry of Jesus, what was the ministry of Jesus? His proclamation of the kingdom was always accompanied by healing and compassion for the wounded. He did not alienate the lepers. He did not alienate the prostitutes. He did not alienate the tax collectors. He always had compassion for them, especially the sinners. That is when, you know, the Cardinal Tagle mentioned a beautiful point, you know. Why did the shepherd go behind the lost sheep? He had 99 other sheep. Why did he go behind the lost sheep? Why did the person go behind the lost coin when we had other coins? Because the sheep, the coin, was my own. It was not somebody else's. It was my own. And if that sheep is wounded, and if it cannot walk home, I will carry it home. You know, that extra care, that extra compassion for the wounded one. This is what we should have, you know, as Catholics, in our families, in our communities. It was a beautiful message, you know, I would say the most beautiful message from the heart that came into this world meeting of families, you know. The wounded one always deserves special attention. The wounded one, if he cannot walk home, we should carry it home. That was the ministry of Jesus. And that's what he said. Jesus saves and heals us in our wounds and vulnerabilities. That's one point, is that, you know, because he comes from the Philippines, he knows, you know, what pain is, what hardship is. He belongs to, you know, a country in Asia where there is a lot of poverty, where there are a lot of problems in society. He said Jesus went through each and every problem that people face today. When he was small, he was chased by a cruel tyrant. He experienced homelessness. He experienced destitution. He experienced each and every wound that people experience in the world today. But so that is why he is able to heal us, because he went through every suffering. He is able to empathize with us in our wounds and suffering, and he heals us in our wounds and vulnerabilities. So as the book of Hebrews says, we have a high priest who is able to, you know, empathize with us in every suffering, because he has gone through every suffering of that. And then, you know, so that's what he said. The mission of the church as the body of Christ, we know that we are all made up of wounded. We are all, the church itself is made up of wounded persons. There is no perfect person in the church. We know that, you know, today's world, you know, tries to find faults with us. It says that you are a Catholic. How could you do this? You know, Catholics are not perfect. No saint was perfect. But every day we try to become more like Christ. And that is what, you know, we are all trying to do. We're trying to become holy. It's not that we are holy. We are all wounded inside, deep inside. So as wounded persons, our job is to empathize with the other wounded and to heal them, to unite them with Christ, to reconcile with them with Christ, to lead people to the healing touch of Jesus. The Cardinal spoke about the story, you know, the paralytic man who was carried by four of his friends, though because they could not enter the house where Jesus was preaching because of the crowd. What they did was they opened the roof and, you know, brought him to the presence of Jesus. That's what the church, that's what a community does. It never gives up until the person is brought to the healing touch of Jesus. Never, never, never give up. So that was also a powerful message, you know. So family should be a loving presence where the healing of Jesus is experienced. In our families, if there is anyone who's deeply wounded, maybe not in our family, but in our extended family, if there is anybody wounded, give them that special compassion that they need, because that's where the healing of Jesus should reach. Never, never, never give up until the Lord touches them. A beautiful message, a powerful message from Cardinal Tagle. And then we had Rick Warren. We all know Rick Warren, like the purpose-driven life, right? He's a very famous author. He's not a Catholic, but he's a pastor. He's a evangelical pastor, and he spoke a beautiful. His session was really beautiful, very simple and very beautiful. And he spoke about joyful families. You know, joyful families are based on God's love. So first thing he said is, you know, God loves us unconditionally. So unless we realize that God loves us, we cannot give it to the members of our families. The first thing that we need to realize is, no matter how worthless I am, no matter how worthless the world says I am, in God's eyes, I am, you know, I am precious and honorable in the sight of God. And no one can replace me in God's sight. God loves me so personally. So this is the first thing that I need to understand before I convey it to my family members. And here I wanted to mention a point mentioned by one of the sisters during the vocation session. You know, normally we hear, when we board a plane, we hear that they make an announcement that when there is a problem, you know, the oxygen mask will drop down. So make sure that you secure an oxygen mask before you secure people around you, before you go to help the others. Sister says, you know, that sounds quite, you know, anti-Catholic, because what we always want to do is help others before we help ourselves. But that's the most important thing, you know. Unless we secure our oxygen mask properly, we will not have the consciousness to secure the masks of our children or the people around us. So it's similar in the case of God's love. The first thing is, we should identify who I am. I should realize that God loves me personally. That's the first step. God forgives me unconditionally. Unless I realize that, I could not convey that same message to my family members. So always remember that God loves us, and that is how he wants us to base our families, on God's love, on his love. We should know that he loves us, that he loves every member of our family in a beautiful, unconditional way. And then he said, you know, a family is built on God's purpose. So today, the world, you know, it defines its own purpose, taking away God from its own lives. But remember, you know, that God, only in God can we truly find the purpose of our lives. No one else can tell us why we are on this earth for. What is the purpose of our family? What is the mission of our family in this world? Only God can show us the purpose. So we should pray together to ask the Lord to reveal his purpose for our family in our lives. And then, a test. This is where, you know, we undergo, unless we write a test, we do not know how much we have progressed or how much we have learned. So God has put us on this earth so that we form a character, and with that character, we go into heaven. If we directly go into heaven, we will not be able to appreciate the beauty of heaven, because we have not suffered on earth, you know, we have not undergone that test. So earth is where we, our character formation happens, and it is with that character we go into heaven. And families fulfill the mission to love. I think we've mentioned that point before about the self-donative love. And one striking point by Rick Warren is that, you know, his father also was a very famous pastor. So Rick Warren's father was on his deathbed, and he was, you know, almost unconscious. And he was actually reaching out with his hand for something. So Rick Warren's wife was asking him, like, what is it? Do you want me to get something for you? He said, so he's, you know, he's still reaching out his hand. And then finally, you know, and Rick Warren, he was sitting there and crying because he knew it was his father's last moments. And you know what this Rick Warren's father, this aged father said? He was reaching out his hand saying, one more for Jesus. Even in that last moment of his life, the only thing in his mind was to reach out one more soul for Jesus. That is the passion that we should have to evangelize, you know. And he's saying that, you know, in the next 1 hour, his father repeated that sentence at least 150 times. One more for Jesus. So that is what, you know, he's saying, reach one more soul for Jesus as a family full of joy. Helen Alvarez said one point, you know, today the world is not going to bother to read the catechism or read research papers or go into different sites and read about what the Catholic Church teaches. They don't have time for all that. You, as you said, you know, you may be the only gospel that the world may ever read. So make sure that your life, and how do we witness as a family full of joy? You know, if we are, you know, gloomy and weary, and then we preach Christ, nobody is going to, you know, experience Christ. So what we should reach out for one more soul for Jesus as a family full of joy. Beauty and joy are our tools to evangelize. You know, I remember one of our shepherds saying, you know, when gay marriage was legalized, you know, rather than finding fault with them, what we should do is we should live our Catholic life more beautifully so that people will understand the beauty of family life, the beauty of the marriage between a man and a woman. That's how we cannot propagate hate, but we should propagate love, beauty and joy through our family life, through living our family life in a most beautiful way. And he said, recover the mission of the church. It's the same thing as Bishop Robert Barron said, always be aware of the mission that the Lord has entrusted us to do, you know. And a few practical ways. This is also one of the breakout sessions. A few practical ways to transmit spirituality in our homes. I think very practical methods, you know. And this was one of the sessions related to how to build your faith in the midst of a busy schedule in life. So one of the things that one of our sisters said, you know, have a prayer bowl at home to write down our prayer requests. So that, you know, everybody can write a prayer request in the morning, and when they come back, maybe as part of the rosary, we can pray for those intentions. And then, you know, have a prayer corner or prayer room in your house where maybe we have the Word of God adorned beautifully, where we have the saints, of saints, the Sacred Heart, everything. So the children will understand how important prayer and worship is for us. And then, you know, have a God table talk, you know, have some time in your family, maybe once a week, where we sit down together and talk about how God worked in our life in the past week, or what are we thankful to God for, share as a family. Then maybe some different table centerpieces for each season and important feasts. Then, you know, frequent visits to the Blessed Sacrament as a family, spending some time before the Blessed Sacrament. Schedule Holy Saturdays to do some good deed, maybe spend some time in a nursing home or an orphanage, so that kids also know, the importance of reaching out and giving self-giving love. And then make it a habit to bless each other at bedtime and while leaving the house. We've heard a lot of points related to this, you know, laying over our hands over our children when they sleep and praying for them. A lot of things, you know, make sure that the presence of God is felt in the family. And as another thing that they shared is, you know, writing down scripture verses and making sure that our children learn at least one word of God each day, depending on their age. Make sure that, you know, that scripture, this reading the scripture and all becomes a part of their daily life too. So just a few practical points. And then I think that is all about the sessions. I tried my best to do justice to, you know, there were a lot of sessions, a lot of people with, Scott Hahn was there. I have not mentioned much of his points, except I just maybe mentioned a simple testimony that he shared. One important sentence that he said is marriage should convert sinners into saints. You know, so one thing that maybe theology of the body also, you know, talks about, that, you know, when we are called into married life to, you know, lift up our spouse into that level of holiness which God wants him or her to be. So one thing, so marriage should convert sinners into saints was one powerful message by Scott Hahn. And I just wanted to share one thing that he said. When they had their first child, Michael, and Scott Hahn was, you know, admiring how beautifully his wife has taken over this new role as a mother and how she was taking care of her child and how he was, you know, just learning from everything. And one night she was very tired and she was, after giving milk, she was, you know, just patting the baby and to allow him to burp and all that. So then Scott Hahn said, okay, I can do this, you know. So he said, okay, Kimberly, why don't you go to sleep? I'll just take care of the baby. And then he went downstairs. And, you know, he was helping the baby to burp, but he did it like much too strong, and then the baby puked on him. So then he was like, you know, he was just thinking that, you know, if somebody asks me, has anyone puked on you before, I would have definitely said no. And I would definitely have gotten irritated with a person who would throw up on me. But at that moment of his life, when he was puked upon for the first time, the only thing he could do was look into the eyes of that baby and say, it's okay as long as you feel good. Okay. And then, you know, he put that baby to sleep and he said, you know, that's when the Holy Spirit, the love of God, you know, actually flowed into his heart. And God was asking him, Scott, do you love this baby? He said, of course, he's my firstborn son. I love him so much. Then I want you to know that I love you more than that. And he said, okay, good. Then God made him realize that, you know, whenever we sin, we are actually throwing up on God. We're actually throwing upon God, but all that God, you know, wants us to do is, you know, just realize that no matter how much we throw upon him, how much ever, you know, we make the mess of his love, he's always loving us the same way as before. Just like he loved his son, even though he threw upon him. It's like God's love doesn't change. And he's like, you know, when God told him that this is how I love him, that love, you know, overflowed into his heart. He's like, I was so speechless. And my eyes were, you know, his eyes were filled with tears. And he slept that night into the morning with a great realization of how much God loves him. Okay, so that was one powerful message by Scott Hahn. His session is also there on the site. And so that is, those are the few things that I wanted to share. So I have just shared that keynote sessions, it is there in the world. If you go to worldmeeting2015.org, you can see the keynote sessions, you can see the papal speeches, all those sessions are there. And then I've just mentioned a few points, which was there in one of the mass books that they gave us. It is Examination of Conscience for Married Couples. If you want, I can share this PPT also by mail, because these are good points for our confession, you know, when we go for confession, to especially examine the conscience related to our for married couples, actually for married couples. A few points, you know, just do you want me to read through all those? Can you see them? It's okay, fine, yeah. So I think that's it, and we are almost at 90.
Okay, that was pretty informative and pretty concise. If anybody has any questions, they can raise it to Anne right now. You might be muted if you have anything. You can unmute yourself and ask.
I didn't take any of these sessions.
Ask her anything on anything more. We'll be able to answer. And moreover, we'll provide the link in the website along with the recording. So just in case you have to.
Okay. Yeah.
And the PPT also.
Yes. So yeah, it was, you know, it was such a beautiful experience. So being able to listen to all these people So I said, you know, the most important thing was, the most important consolation was, you know, all of them go through struggles like us, but through grace, they receive the power to handle their situations in a most beautiful way. So, you know, and most important thing that struck me was their eyes were filling with tears whenever they spoke about God and whenever they spoke about their spouse. So, you know, they had that great personal experience with God, and that was helping them to love their spouse the way God wants them to love them. So that's the most important thing, I guess, you know. Everything else is, you know, continuous struggle for every one of us. We're all learning. So this is most important, you know, having our personal relationship with God and a beautiful relationship with our spouse and our children. So working on it and receiving grace from the sacraments. And that's, you know, walking on our way of holiness every day. So. Anybody has questions? I think.
Thank you, Anchiji.
Thompson, how did
you end there now? One thing, I think we spoke when I was also there for the weekend.
I think
pretty much you summarized it beautifully. And one thing I did was when after the weekend, I went and bought the copy of Parenting with Grace. This was the Chair Couples book, right? I think it's a beautiful, beautiful book that I think every parent must read. I mean, it's so deep that we can chew on every page, and you know, there's something that's there on Amazon, and it's pretty cheap. It's called Parenting with Grace, Raising Catholic Parents' Guide to Raising Almost Perfect Kids.
I guess we are running out of time. If there is any quick queries, we can answer, and then otherwise we'll wrap it up.
Vivek, I was just wondering if anybody is recording this session.
Yes, we are recording.
So maybe later you can send it to us. We can give it to somebody else who was not able to listen also.
Sure, no problem. Yeah, all the webinars will be in the webinar section of the 4Live website. And I'll put that on the Facebook page also. As soon as it has to be edited in the formatter, and immediately it will be out. Our team will be working on it.
Okay, sure.
Okay, I guess maybe we'll wrap up. And if you want to just do a concluding prayer, and then.
Lord Jesus, we want to thank you for this beautiful time, Lord. We were able to experience your presence in our midst, Lord. Lord Jesus, thank you for working in us so beautifully and so powerfully, Lord. Lord, help us to realize the great mission, Lord. Help us to understand the great mission that you have given us, Lord Jesus, to love as you have loved us, Lord, and to be witnesses in this world as our with our families, Lord, being full of joy. Lord, may the beauty of our families inspire others to Lord Jesus. Lord, thank you for the beautiful love that you have showered upon us, Lord. Thank you for loving us with that unconditional love. Thank you for this beautiful time. Thank you for this beautiful opportunity. Lord, help us to grow in a way of holiness as you want us to grow, Lord Jesus. Holy Spirit, be with us every moment of our lives, strengthening us in our mission to love as the family fully alive. Mother Mary, we thank you for interceding for us in these moments. Continue to pray for us, dear loving Mother. May the Holy Family always inspire us to be a family for God. Saint Joseph, pray for us. Saint John Paul II, pray for us. Yeah.